Let us all stand.
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted. Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I honor all the Master, my heart shall be Thy throne, my life I give.
Called to worship. Sing unto the Lord, unto God, our strength. Make a joyful noise unto God of Jacob. Take a psalm and bring hither and the timbrel, the present harp with the psaltery. Psalms 81, verses 1 and 2. You sing the doxology.
Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, it's no one.
Give thanks, O God and O Father, we are so thankful to Thee for Thy love and Thy goodness and Thy mercies towards us. Thanking Thee because You have helped us to see another day. And most, O Lord, we can reflect our minds and our thoughts on Thee as Creator God, as Redeemer God, and as our Sustainer. This moment, Lord, we come to worship You. We left our homes, we left our friends and relatives, and we came into this place where You are pleased so that Your name will be pleased. As we worship You today, O God, set our minds and our hearts towards heaven. And as we utter our praise and our thanksgiving to You, we pray that You will accept the same in Jesus' name.
The opening hymn is number 10. Number 10 is the opening hymn.
Thank you.
scripture reading we're taking from Psalms 24, verse 1 and 2. Psalms 24, verse 1 and 2. Together, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Amen.
Now, dear Lord, as we pray, our great God and our Heavenly Father. Lord, we come before you, we bow before you this morning. Lord, we give you praise and we give you thanks this morning for the breath of life. Lord, we thank you, dear God, that we can, as a family, as a people, dear Lord, congregate. Lord, we are of every kindred, of every tribe, of every tongue, and we have come together in your name, dear Lord, to bless you, to praise you, to worship you, and to obey you, dear God. We give you thanks, dear God, that you have brought us from different walks of life, from different societal class. We have brought us from different trades and different careers and different abilities, Lord, and you have combined us together in the body of Christ as brothers and sisters. And Lord, we give you thanks for the blood of Jesus, dear God, so that where there may be division and there may be strife, but within your church, dear Lord, we are family. And we thank you, dear God. And Lord, we thank you, dear God, that you are a God of love. For Lord, it is because you are a God of love that you are worthy to be worshipped. Because Lord, we are changed into that which we worship. And dear God, this is why, oh God, there is no other God like you. There is no other God that will give themselves for their creation. There is no other God that will, for the good of the world, sacrifice themselves on the cruel cross. There is no other God that will allow their creation to spit in their face and slap and pierce their side with swords and spears. There is no other God. There is no other God that will turn the other cheek when they are smitten in the face. There is no other God. There is no other God, oh God, when men would curse and blaspheme, and yet you would allow them to have the breath of life still. There is no other God. And so, God, we worship you, dear God. We pray that we will be changed into your image. Oh, God, that we will be merciful like you, that we will be abundant in goodness like you, that we would forgive iniquity and transgression and sin like you, dear God. Oh God, that we would be giving selflessly like you, dear God. Oh God, that we would bless the just and the unjust like you, dear God. Oh God, that we would not just hail our friends, but also our enemy, dear God. Because you said that we should feed our enemy and give them water when they thirst. oh God, because this is what you do every day, 24 hours a day. Father, we thank you, dear God, that you have spared our life through the storms of the week. Yes, there were damages, oh God, but these are opportunities for us as your people to bless those who are not fortunate as we are. This is an opportunity for your goodness to shine through. This is an opportunity for men and women to know that there is a God who loved them. There's a God who is concerned about their plight. And there is an enemy who wishes to destroy them. Father, we bring those who are sick in one way or another before you, dear God. We know that you concern. We know that you grieve with those who grieve. We know, dear God, that sickness and affliction is not part of your divine plan, dear God. And so, God, we pray that you would touch those who are afflicted. Touch the affected body part or the organ or whatever it may be. Even if they are grieving in spirit, dear Lord, touch them, dear God, with the Holy Spirit, dear God, so that they may be able to have that inner joy and that inner peace, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the storm, dear God, that they will be able to know that there is a God who loves them, dear Father. I pray, oh God, that you would wash us, dear Lord. Cleanse our spirit, dear Lord. Help us, dear God. If there be any blot in our character, dear Lord, cleanse it by the spirit and the blood of Jesus, dear Father. Dear God, we pray for our messenger this morning, even Elder Richards, dear Father. As he presents the message this morning, we pray that as we hear it, dear God, we would allow it to be planted in the fertile soil of our heart, dear God. Don't let the enemy come and snatch it away, dear Father. But, oh God, help us to bear fruits of righteousness, dear God. And we pray that, Lord, something would be said this morning to give us a clearer understanding of you, for us to have a clearer picture like you, so that we would not be like the people on the mountain with Elijah, to be of two opinions, and that we can't decide whether you are good or whether you are evil. We can't decide whether you are for us or whether you are against us. But, oh God, we will all realize that you love us with an everlasting love, that you care for us more than we care for ourselves, and that your only desire for us is that we make it into the kingdom to be with you. And so, dear God, may we have a blessed Sabbath sitting today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. I'm sure that God is happy, the Godhead, the angels, the heavenly body is happy to see so many persons out here today. And so, in a very special way, I'd like to welcome everyone here at church this morning. Sister Green, our head superintendent, a very special welcome is extended to you. We all know that she has been out on sick leave for a while, so we're very happy to see her here with us this morning. When I came in, I heard her voice actually before I saw her down in the class. So we know that she's well and ready to go back to her official duty shortly, I presume. Just turn to the person next to you, give them a little hug, a little shake hand, and say welcome, and let us all get ready for the Word of God. Thank you.
Yes, we shall now worship the Lord with our tithes, offerings, and gifts. He has acquired a tenth, and this his claim, as the very least that man should return unto him. He says, I give you 9/10, why I require 1/10, that is mine. When man withhold the 1/10, they rob God. The day comes now waiting us for the tithes, offerings, and gifts. Bring it tight in the storehouse.
Give me for thine own, whatever gifts may be. All that we have is thine own, a trust, O Lord, from me.
Lord and Father, we give you thanks for blessing us and for giving us the ability, dear God, and to return to you our tithes and offerings and gifts. May God, we pray that you bless us as we endeavor to serve you and to commit our lives to you, dear God. We pray, dear Father, that the offerings that we have returned to you, dear Father, that they'll be a blessing to some, bring a blessing to someone, dear Father. Bless those who have the responsibility to disburse of these funds. Pray that God that you guide them to so do. And we thank you for hearing and answering our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning again. I don't want to be held guilty for the sin of omission. So at this time, I would like to welcome all the visitors among us. And Brother Fergus, we like to acknowledge your presence here. Amen. Okay, so visitors, welcome. Sorry about that just now. Our hymn of meditation would be hymn 93, All Things Bright and Beautiful. While we're singing, we're meditating, and we put in ourselves, our hearts, in preparation for the message, hymn 9:3. think we meditate better when we seated, so you would sit and sing.
All things thanks are beautiful, all creatures great and small. All things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The humble and the mountain, the rivers running by, the sunset on the morning that brightens up the sky. All things bright and all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The cold wind in the winter, the pleasant summer sun, pleasant summer, the ripe fruits in the garden, he made them everyone. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The Jesus I see them and live that we can tell. How great is God Almighty, who has hidden all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small. All things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all.
Amen. At this time, I want to take the privilege to welcome every one of us in the house of the Lord today. Amen. I tell you, when you see you wake up and have life, give God thanks. Amen. And more so when you're healthy, you can move, give him praise. There are many today who are not healthy. And here, what did he write us in? He gave us eyes to see them. When you could see, what a blessing, eh? Yeah. And some of us have lips, but we don't want to sing. You come to church and we're singing, and I don't know what you're doing. But it's a lips that we might tell how great is God Almighty, who has done all things well. I say, when you come to church, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. He didn't say Mount Moriah alone, but he said all ye lands. You come to church and you're afraid to sing, what happened? When do you sing? All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful. It is not Ken Richards made them, now Sister Jack, now Brother Rogers. The Lord God, the creator of heaven and earth, made them all. And so, dear beloved, I think this week was a challenging week for Vincentian. I think this week reminds Vincentian that there's a God who seated upon his throne and ruled all things well. And so God will do things sometime for people to get awakened. And maybe some of you didn't leave where you are living to see out at the countryside. But it is good for you to go and see. You will see the mystery that rivers could do. Yes, I tell you, I see the writers ahead, the purple-headed mountain, the river running by, the sunset and the morning that brighten up the sky. When you get into places like going up to Congo Valley, you will marvel to see what the river do there. It took away the entire road. And there was a bypass bridge that they built when they were doing the big bridge. You can't even tell that a foundation for a bridge was there. I saw them trying to rescue it from the seashore. Then when you get over into Dixon O'Brien Valley, it's a mystery. Well, I've gone over to Sandy Bay, but people told me over there it's terrible. Dear beloved, it's marvel to see what water could do. And so sometimes we live in this world and we think that I this and I that and I that and I that. Who I? God ruleth all things well. We are just finite man and God is infinite. And so I said to us this morning, whenever you wake up to see a new day, praise him. And if you don't wake up, that means you fall asleep. But if you fall asleep, make sure you fall asleep in Jesus. Because when he comes, will be another mystery. So today we're going to meditate. This begins our week of stewardship. And for this week of stewardship, we're going to study God as creator. It's good to remind the world, it's good to remind us that God is creator. And he is ruler, he is owner. And we are just stewards. Every one of us. So if you hear church call out this morning, Stewardship Secretary Ken Richards, you are a steward too. Every one of us is a steward as before God. We have to give account for our lives, the life which we live. We have to give account for everything in this world. Dear beloved, I tell you, as I was thinking this week, it made me remember the psalm. In Psalm 19, 1 and 2. Let's see if we could read and say what the psalmist said there. Psalm 19, 1 and 2. It says what? The heaven declares the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Verse 2. Day after day what? Speech and showeth the... So dear beloved, the heaven declares the glory of God. It was the same psalmist who once said, when I consider thy heaven, the heaven, when he consider the work of God's finger, when he consider the moon and the stars which God put in place, he once asked the question, what is man that thou art mindful of him? I believe this psalmist was thinking of those vast planets out there like Jupiter, Neptune, Uranus. I think he was thinking of the sun, 93 million miles away from Earth, yet scorching man on Earth. I think he was thinking of moon, 240 what? How far it is from Earth? 240? 40,000 miles from Earth, yet it lit the Earth even better than the lamps. So the psalmist think of all the wonders of God. He think of the cloud where the snow and the rain originates. And he said, what is man that thou art mindful of him? But I want to tell you, dear beloved, God made us to praise him. God made us so that we can worship him. And that's why we are here today, to worship him. And that's why when you come to church, come with a heart prepared to worship God. Come with a heart prepared to sing out your soul to the Lord. Come with a heart prepared to meditate on God's word. Don't come to talk the comments of the week. Don't come to say where you saw Brother Richards yesterday. Come to worship God in the beauty of holiness. May we pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for this moment. We give you thanks that we will now meditate on your words. And we pray now that your Holy Spirit will guide us into your truth. We pray that your Holy Spirit will open up our spiritual minds and understanding our vision to comprehend your written pages. We pray now, Lord, that you will hide each of us behind the shadow of the cross of Calvary. And may Jesus Christ be lifted up. Be thou with me, O God, at this time. I pray that you will remove sin and self, O God. Make me a vessel fit for your use now, and use me with power, with clarity, with fluence, with eloquence, that as I speak today, your words will be understood by even the smallest child among us. Let your blessings be multiplied upon us. And when we leave here today, may we leave rejoicing once more. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're thinking of God as creator. And there, beloved, as we read the Bible, the first thing we learn is that God is creator God. Is that true? Yes. Genesis said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So right there, don't bother yourself with those men out there who want to tell you about evolution. Even they themselves believe that there's a God. I believe if they were in St. Vincent this week, they would have known that there's a God. Where you hear dead wash up, grave open and dead come out. Huh? Cemetery wash away. Think of it. Think of what is happening. Think of all the rain that pours down. But in spite of all, God has done all things well. God is creator God. And Revelation warns us that the last message that will be proclaimed in the world will also put in manifestation again that God is the creator. Let us read Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7. Revelation 14. 6 and 7. What it says there? And I saw. Yes. 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 So you see that? What it says there? So we read in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. He created heaven and the earth. And if you go to the account of Genesis, you will see right down where God created man. And today, we notice that in the beginning, God. And in the end, we will still see that God is creator God. I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel, the gospel that will never done. And then with this gospel, it will go to every nation. It will go to every kindred, to every tongue, and to every people. And we heard that visitation this evening. And there, beloved, as I think of visitation, I remember God, even when he was sending out his disciples in Acts, he said, begin first at Jerusalem. And so sometimes when we think of the gospel, we think of gospel all in Africa and all in Uganda and those places. But I want to remind us that we should do some visitation in our homes too. There are some people in our homes that need to know Jesus. People whom we mingle with, whom we dwell with, our siblings. I sometimes try to walk with mine. They seal in their belief. But we still have to tell them the word. My brother died already, and I tried to talk to him many times before he died, but he stayed in his belief. My sisters came from abroad, and they're still in their belief. But nevertheless, I must tell them they respect me for what I believe. Amen. Yes, because why I know they respect me? All of them came and they said, I know our brother died, but we want nobody else to preach but you. So therefore, I know that they respect us. And they believe the truth, but they are so riveted there, it needs power to remove them. So as we spread this message, remember those in our homes. Sometimes we leave our homes and we go and visit out, but there is somebody there whom we must talk to every day. But God also give us some methods to deal with those in our homes. He said, show loving kindness to them. Don't curse them every day and say you're not coming to God. He said, if the wife will show nice loving care and attention, she will win the husband. And if the husband will do the same, he will win the wife. And we will win our children. And so, dear beloved, this everlasting gospel must go not only in our homes, but to every nation, every kindred, tongue, and people. We must say with a loud voice. Sometimes we don't want to speak. You have to ask somebody, could you say what you say again? But God said with a loud voice, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made the heaven and the earth. This is the message. Worship God who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. So God is creator God. I'm certain we are convinced of that by now. And that's the reason we are here today. One hymn writer said, we go to meet the Savior, his glorious face to see. What manner of behavior doth with this hope agree? May God's illumination guide hearts and hand aright, so that when he comes, we will be able to be changed with him. Dear beloved, when we come to worship, we must remember we are worshiping a thrice holy God. And so we must come prepared. Israel, in the time when God would have told them to come to worship, he said, none must appear before him empty. And I think that had a twofold message. The first message in it is that you must come with a prepared heart to worship the Creator God, to give praise and thanksgiving to his most holy and blessed name. And so that was one. The other application is you must also bring your offering. Remember, we are stewards. God is creator. God is owner. And so when we come, we bring our tithe and our offering. And somebody said, when I give, I don't have enough. Well, if you recognize him as the one who owns everything, if you recognize him as the one who owned the mountain, the cattle upon the thousand hill, the gold and the silver, if you recognize him as the one who gives us life every day and strength, you will do what he said to do first, and everything else will be okay. Sometimes we don't put God to the test enough. God, this is not mine. You said to do it first. I'm going to do it first. I remember Elijah was hungry. He visited this woman and he asked her for bread. She said, man of God, don't you know there's famine in this land? The famine is so severe and so long. My little flour has almost run out. What we have remaining there is to make the last meal. A little flour and a little oil. The man of God said to the woman, do what I ask you to do first. And so she in faith went and she did it first. Prepare him the meal. And the Bible said by the time she done, for all the years of the famine, the flour never run out, neither the oil run dry. That's the God we serve. Do what he asks you to do first. Mary said at the wedding at Canaan, when the wine ran out, she went to Jesus. She said, Jesus, wine finished. Jesus said to her, woman, my hour is not yet come. Mary had so much faith in Jesus that she didn't take that as an insult, but she turned to the disciples and she said, whatsoever he asks you to do, do it. Amen. wasn't too long when Jesus looked around, he saw pots. He said, remove the stones from the pot. I think some of us have too much stones in our pots. Stones doesn't tell of the Holy Spirit. Water is the Holy Spirit. So Jesus said, remove the stones from our hearts. Put the Holy Spirit in. Fill them with water. And then he said, draw out. And then they received wine. It was the best. I said all of that to say to us, what God asks us to do, do it first. Don't wait until you can't do it. And so this morning, dear beloved, he is Creator God. He created the world and all that is therein. He created and then he made man. And after he made the man, he made the woman. And he made everything for our comfort. It is because of sin why we are suffering. Because man disobeyed God. And because of disobedience, the entire human race has suffered and we are suffering. All that you are seeing happening is because of sin. After the flood this week, many villages didn't have water. All in Georgetown, they were out of water. They had to go for miles trying to get water. It is because of sin. But I said to us this morning that there is a solution for sin. And the solution is in Christ Jesus. But for the solution to work, if you have contact cement going to work, you have to follow the instruction. It first says clean the surface. So you have to clean your surface. And then after you finish cleaning the surface, it says apply the solution thinly on both sides. Then it says wait 4 minutes until it is dry. And then take your time and fit it because it's going to contact. And when it contact, it ain't coming out back so easy. And so dear beloved, when we clean ourselves up and we apply Jesus, and we cling to him, he said, abide in me, and I will abide in you. No more can ye except you abide in me. And so, dear beloved, we must remember that God is the one in control. Let us read Isaiah 42 and verse 5. There's a message there for us. Isaiah 42 and verse 5. What is that there? Thus said, read it. So God, the Lord, created the heavens, stretched them out. He spread them forth. He spread forth the earth. And that which cometh out of it, he that giveth breath unto the people. So then we realize, dear beloved, this body that we are boasting in, oh, it's me. I don't care about nobody else. Who he be, he think he could talk to. All that keeping us here is the breath that God give us. When the breath remove, we become sand. That's why at the grave we said, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. From dust you come, to dust you return. But God shows us that this would not be the end. He who had the power to create Adam from the dust of the earth, he will have the power to bring back every sleeping soul from that is buried there, from righteous Abel right to the last man. And so, dear beloved, this is the God we are serving. The spirit he gave to them that walked therein. So we have to recognize that it is God who controls us. It was sometime this week, somebody told me, one of my friends in Kingston, one of the merchants in Kingston, died mall. And then when I went to check, they said she wasn't really sick. Sunday morning, she woke up, said she's not feeling well. And then they took her to the casualty, and while she was there, she died. There are some people who will die immediately. God said they cut off immediately, and that without remedy. And there are some who will have prolonged sickness, who will have so much time to repent. But because we are alive, there is hope in us. We have to recognize that God is creator and take him as our Lord in our life. We have to remove all the images, all the idols from our lives. Some of us cherish too much idols in our life. We like to boast of what I have. The big bank account, the possessions, the property, the nice ride, whatever we have. But when we look at it, nothing is ours. The land that we are fighting for, I bought some lands over there, people fighting me until I just leave it in bush. I don't even interested in it again. They're fighting me too much. Because I read in the Bible, the land will never be ours. He said, generation comes and generation go, and the land remain. And then it boils down again to what we are studying. We are only steward. Sometimes you are steward, you have to take good care. But if you see people want to kill you, don't make them kill you for no piece of land, man. No, don't make that happen, man. Live out your life in Christ. And let Christ fight for you. And God said he will fight. He fights slowly sometimes. Because of the Bible said the mills of God grind slower, one writer. It grinds so slow that sometimes you feel he's not hearing you. I remember Asaph in the psalm, he said he almost come to the end of the cliff. He was going to turn back. He may be calling upon God and he can't get what he wants. He may be looking at all his friends and neighbor prospering. So much people are coming up with the latest ride. So much people are having this. And he said, I'm a child of God and I can't get what I want. So the Bible said he almost come to the end of the cliff. But when he got there, I think the Holy Spirit spoke to him. I think the angel of the Lord turned him around. And the angel of the Lord said, go into the sanctuary. In the sanctuary, there is refuge. In the sanctuary, there is deliverance. In the sanctuary, there is peace. In the sanctuary, there is joy forevermore. So he went into the sanctuary. And when he went in and he prayed to God, he realized that the end of those out there is bitter. While the end for the child of God is sweet. Oh, dear beloved, you may have some trials. Every one of us. But God is the one in control. He is creator. And he will do all things well. I know I could assure you this morning. The psalmist David once declared, I was young. And he lived to see 70 years. And he said, now I am old at age 70. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. And this God whom we serve, he is able. He might not give you abundance. He might give you just enough. But I remember the wise man Solomon. He once said, Lord, I want you to do me a favor. He said, I don't want you to leave me in poverty. Or I may beg my bread and insult you. Just give me bread enough to sustain me one day at a time, Lord Jesus. That's all I'm asking of you. But because of his honest prayer, God didn't just do that for him. God made him rich. He was a rich ruler. I said, dear beloved, we might not have the world goods as we so desire. But what more do we want but life in Christ? What more do we want but salvation in him? What more do we want but to have the blessed hope knowing that we are living for him? And that one of these days when all of life troubles and trials are over, we'll rest forevermore and heaven beautiful shore. God is creator God. And God wants us to understand today that we are creatures. He is creator and we are creatures. And God wants us to understand today that we are not equal with him. And so we must worship him in spirit and in truth. The angels in heaven, the cherubims in heaven, do you know this? The Bible said they carry six wings? Is it the brother Rogers? He said with two wings they cover their feet. With two wings they fly. And what they do with the other two? They cover their what? Faces. Yes, and if that could be for the angel who never sinned, what about us as creature? Creature, God wants us to obey him. He wants us to recognize our possession. We are not equal. Neither we are partner with him. He is the creator and we are the work of his creation. This means, dear beloved, that he is an incomparable being. Nothing is equal to him or reaches his condition. He is absolutely different from everything created. For example, he does not have a beginning. God does not have a beginning. While we do have an origin, he is self-sufficient. But we are dependent on him. You know, sometimes I like to just look at life. And I just be marveled, you know, marveled. God gave me four sons in my house. And I know them born from a babe when they came from the hospital. And I never yet a day saw them when they were growing. I never see the bone stretch this way today, that tomorrow, that the next day. But the guys grow up to 6 feet. Who did it? It's God. We have no control over ourselves. But God wants us to know that he is the one in control. He wants us to know that we must depend on him. He is an infinite God. We are finite. We are limited. In other words, the object is not equal to the creator. And so this very moment, dear beloved, God wants us to understand that God is the creator of the best protection against idolatry. Amen. Idolatry is simple, giving a place to God, to a person or thing. Do you know that sometimes people afraid to leave their homes? Yes, I had a cousin came from England, and he brought down so much things with him. Among the things that came in the container was what you call a chunk. You know the English chunk? And every time I go to invite him to church, he telling me, he can't leave home. He have to there to watch a chunk. Hyacinth and I will visit him, will speak with him. Oh, Ken boy, I understand, but I can't leave home. Somebody must be home to watch the chunk. So I said, so when you, what happened? You don't leave the house at all? He said, yes. If I leave in, so my wife had to stay there. But guess what happened to him? He got sick. Cancer took him over. When the cancer took him, he had to leave the chunk and go to hospital. He subsequently died. The chunk remained there. And God's sending a good message. God's message concerning people like that who have so much things as idol in their life is, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his life? Oh, God have already made all provision for us. He gave man instruction in the garden. Man listened to the serpent. Didn't follow God's instruction. Sin came in because the serpent said, God know the day you eat. Your eyes shall be open. You shall be like God, knowing good and evil. God hiding something from you. This is what happening to us in life, you know. Some young people will tell them, man, your eye need to open. When your eye open, the amount of things you see, some people can't contain it. Too much problem. Too much worry. Better stay in Christ. Let Christ lead you one day at a time. And so, as man Satan's instruction, sin came in, and death by sin. All kind of aches and pain and suffering. And so this moment, God wants us to know we need to remove idols from our lives. Remove them. Anything that will hinder your service to God. Don't wait until death comes. Bringing somebody in, remain in the church for service doesn't mean that will decide their eternal destiny in Christ. Your eternal destiny have to be secured while you are alive. Yes. And so God wants all things that will hinder you from serving him to be removed. Remove completely and let God occupy our life. It is said here that God is our creator. Also expresses that clarity that we are his stewards. Therefore, he is our owner. And he wants to remind us, because he's our owner, that the earth is the Lord. Everything in the earth is the Lord. The world belongs to him. And that what we own is his. It may sound strange to you, but it is true. Nothing you got now is yours. You know how much people save money at building a loan and think they would have get it. And when the time come, some still struggling. I had some there too. When they do call me, they tell me they took out permanent shares and they split up the rest in segments. So when the year come, you get a piece, you get a piece, till it finish. I say, Lord, have mercy. So I ask them, so when you get all the pieces, when will you get the piece they took out for the permanent share? They say, no, they're not going to word on that. There are a lot of people who had put their trust in British American insurance and in colonial life, and they lose millions of dollars. That's why God said, lay up treasures in heaven, where neither thieves nor moth nor rust will come in and destroy it. You see, on this earth, people are like to steal. They are cunning. They will come and show you some packages that look so good. I remember once I told a friend of mine, that's too much money to put one place. If you know you have that money to put up, put it in several places. If this one collapses, that one ain't gonna collapse. The friend said, praise God, I gave them that advice. But I say all that to say a lot of people put their trust in earthly possession and they are leaving Christ out. But one writer, I always love to quote him. He said, while we are living in this earth, to lose your wealth is just a loss. Wealth could always come back. Job did lose all his wealth, don't you? And he get back much more than before. So he said, to lose your wealth is but a loss. But then he came back, he said, to lose your health is more. And then finally he said, but to lose your soul is such a loss that nothing can endure. So to maintain your life in Christ, recognize God as Creator God. Recognize God as the God of the universe. Recognize God as the one who controls everything. Christian stewardship is based on the notion that God is to occupy the first place in each aspect of our life. God is to occupy the first place in each aspect of our life. Remember, God had said to Israel, whatever you do for a living, you must return 1/10. So those Israelites who are doing sheep, when 10 pass, one for God. When 10 pass, one for God. When 10 pass, one for God. In their fields, when they do the measurement, part for God. In our church today, a lot of people said, no, they're not following God's way, but they are not richer. They are not richer. Still worries to pay Vinlec. Still worries to play Carib Cable. Still worries to play Columbus. worries to pay water bill, worries to buy food. I say if we put God first and we commit our ways to the Lord, He will direct our path. In all our ways, acknowledge Him. When we acknowledge Him, He will direct. David said, I have never seen the righteous forsaken after living for 70 years. Neither his seed begging bread. There are those who withhold God's tithe and offering and they are still begging. God said, what they have, they go in pockets with holes and in purse with holes. God is calling us to recognize Him as the center of our lives. When we understand the attribute of God as creator, we will be able to understand the limit of our function in the world. In reality, the best that can be said about a steward is that it is someone that recognizes that he is not the owner or proprietor of anything. You get the message? And if you want to ask me, I could tell it's true. If you want to play bright, don't pay your taxes for a long time. See if after a time they can't take it from you. You notice I have to be paying taxes every year? Huh? Yeah? All drivers have to pay driver's license every year. So we don't owe nothing. We are stewards. We keep paying for the same thing over and over and over again. If you have a phone at home, a landline, you have to pay rent for it every month. We don't owe nothing. But dear beloved, when we trust in God, when we trust in God, God is able to work things out for us. Because one of these days, we'll no longer be a steward or not. Life will pass. It will pass. And if life doesn't pass, then Christ will come and He'll meet you alive. And if Christ come and meet us alive, He said, the dead in Christ will rise first, according to 1 Thessalonians. And then said, then we who are alive and remain in Christ shall be caught up to meet Him. So one of these is we must leave planet Earth. God said, the heaven, this earth will pass away. It will pass away. So it's nothing to hang on to. If you want a good life, you have to stay in Christ. Since God created us, He has the right over us and can perfectly assign responsibilities, fix limits, and ask for accountability. And I want to remind us that every one of us will have to give an account for ourselves. Every one of us. One of these days, one day, we have to give an account. The Bible said, according to Revelation, every man, small and great, will stand before God. So we have to give accountability. We must develop a relationship with Him that is characterized by obedience. And I think this is the word. We must develop this relationship that is characterized by obedience. And not only obedience, but by faithfulness. It will be so good that when Jesus comes to reward us, we will hear, well done, Sister Marlene Williams. You have been faithful over little things. I'm going to make you rulers over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. I could call some people name because they are my friends. So you don't wonder why I call her name. Well done. Yes, dear beloved, it will be characterized by faithfulness. How faithful are we to God? How faithful are we to His service? Churches now have an election, so your names will come up for certain office. And as I will always tell some people, even though your name didn't call for a particular office, we are all laborers in the vineyard. And so sometimes, even though you know this in this office, it might be better for you because you're not bored and you're free. free to go wrong and do what you want to do. So we are all laborers in the vineyard. So we must be faithful in our service. And finally, we must be faithful in our love. Let love be without assimilation. Oh, dear beloved, let us be faithful in our love to God and our love to our fellow men. I know some people very hard to love, but love them. Only love could win them. You get the message? They're hard to love, but love them. Only love could win them. I'm going to give you a story. This is a true story of myself. When we went to Mount Pleasant to live, we lived there without water. We didn't have water. We had electricity, but we didn't have water. So I went to the people to ask for water. They said they cannot connect the water to us because the proprietor of the land didn't pay to get the water connect. So in the meanwhile, my neighbor started to give us some water. We even offered to pay them. One evening when Hyacinth went for the water, she met the big pit bull tie on the pipe. And that pit bull no easy dog to go with. So she stand up the road and she call until. And you know Hyacinth got a loud voice. She call. Nobody answering. So I came out the house. I said, Hyacinth, people down the sea could hear you calling. If the people wanted to come in, they would have done come and open me. And I see the dog tied there. That is a message. So Hyacinth and I, we didn't have any vehicle at the time. We took our journey out the road. We catch a vehicle. And we go up to Chapman's. And we get some buckets. You know, our people will help us. And then we get a vehicle because Hyacinth's family had vehicle. And they brought down water for us. And so from that, every day they had to bring us some water. The man never look out to talk to us, you know. All we know, the dog tied there. And that's all. The other neighbor who used to get some water from him, he ran a permanent hose from the pipe to the neighbor. And it took months. We pass, we saying hello, they're not answering. Well, then I finally got a car. I bought a piece of old diet to share it. And one day, when I was going down, I saw the bus leave them off. And one big rain came down like it was coming Tuesday. One big rain came down. I said, well, they're not talking to me. Let me see the drama now between me and them, because the two of them is serious asthmatic cases. Serious asthmatic. So I cruised down. I stopped. I said, well, I notice the rain is coming. I know you all asthmatic. Would you like a ride? They said, praise God, praise God. I opened the car, and they came in. I put in the goods. Okay, then I dropped them. When he reached, he said, Ken, I'm sorry for where we do you now. I'm sorry for where we do you all. But is your friend who came and tell us certain things why we do that? He said, but if you're doing a good for me, you know I don't have water, you should call me and tell me what the friend say. And, you know, we'd have it trash out. He said, the friend don't want me to survive. That's why he did that. So we get the thing trash out. And then, but think of the suffering he caused. You see? Because people are like that. When we live in this world, we'll meet this kind of problem. But God said, be faithful in love. Even though problems come, be faithful in love. I think I heard the word declared, and now abideth. How we go again? How we go? Faith, hope, charity. But the greatest of these is love. Be faithful in love. Be faithful in love. And so there be love. I know sometimes some people hard to love. But be faithful in love. Because there are some people who think when we go to heaven, they will tell God, Ken Richards, come in and make he enter. Heaven is not for him. But heaven is for all of us who are saved by the blood of Jesus. Heaven is for everyone who is saved by the blood of Jesus. No matter what sin we committed, as long as we go to that fountain, there lose all the guilty stain. That's why Jesus came to die. He came and demonstrated love. He said, greater love had no man than this, than a man to lay down his life for his friends. Our friends may betray us. Our friends may deny us, but be faithful in love. Recognize God as creator God, and let us live a victorious Christian life. May God richly bless us as we continue to go through this week. Meditate on these things. Now we'll sing from the hymn number 88. Hymn number 88. I sing the mighty power of God that makes the mountain rise, that spreads the flowing seas abroad and builds the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day, the moon shine full at his command, and all his stars obey. Yeah, let us sing, let us sing, let us worship the Lord, let us sing to the glory and beauty of God.
I sing the mighty that makes the mountain rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and build the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day, the moon to stretch at his command, and all the stars obey.
Maybe if the stars obey, we are human beings. God made us with intelligence. We are the best of God's creation. As a matter of fact, he put everything in our hands to rule. So because the stars obey, we could obey. Maybe we were not faithful. Maybe there's not enough love, whatever it be. God is calling us to obey. And if you want to leave where you are in faith and come forward so that we can have prayer, when we sing this next stanza, I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed a creature of his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed. Where I turn mine eyes, if I suffer the ground I tread, I gaze upon the sky. If you want, you are so led by the Spirit, come forward in faith. More prayer, more power, and God will be able to help us. Just as we sing, leave where you are.
That is the Lord, it's so good. He formed the creatures of this world and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed. Wherever yearn mine eye, if I survey the ground I tread, I gaze upon the...
Don't be afraid to come. Don't be afraid. One little move of faith could make a difference in your life. One little move of faith makes a big difference in your life. Let's sing over that verse. There's not a plant or flower below. Let's sing over this verse. There's not a plant or flower below, as somebody else will move.
That makes the mountains low and clouds of rise and grows the snow. Does not abide thy throne. Creatures that borrowed life from thee are subject to thy care. There's not a place where we can be. Oh, God is present there.
Remember, one little move of faith makes a big difference in your life. You might not know it, but it makes a lot of difference. Remove self, remove pride, remove everything, and move in Jesus' name, as Brother Morris will pray for us.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, here are your people, those who keep the commandments of God and has the faith and testimony of Jesus. Lord, we know that you are presently holding back the four winds of strife. You are commanding the angels, hold, hold, until we seal the servants of God in their forehead. Oh God, we know that you are sealing us with your divine character. Lord, you are giving us the image of Jesus so that we can be just like him. And that this dark world will have us as the light. As they behold us, they will see that there is a God who is loving, who is caring, who is selfless. A God who is not willing that any should perish, but all that should come to repentance and receive life. Oh God, we pray that you will seal all the believers that are here. That we will become rest, that we would rest in the truth of your divine character of love. Oh God, that your commandments will be second nature to us, dear God. That we would prefer righteousness than unrighteousness. That, Lord, we will prefer holiness to unholiness. So that, Lord, when you make that declaration, he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. That we may be on the side of holiness. That when you make the declaration, he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. That we would have formed characters of righteousness that will stand the test of the trial that is to come. Lord, we pray that as we depart, that you not only go before us, that you not only go around us, that you not only go with us, but you go within us, dear God. So that, oh God, that as we go into the communities, in our homes, in our workplaces, dear God, we will be as arks of your covenant, bearing your presence wherever we may go. And so to your name's honor and glory, we submit ourselves, dear Lord, as living sacrifices, Lord. Do what you may with us and finish the work which you started within us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Shalom.
My friend, shalom, my friend, shalom, shalom. May filled be with you, healthies be with you, shalom, shalom. Attend you, angels defend, shalom, shalom. God mercy befriend you unto the end, shalom, shalom. We meet again, shalom.